The promise of space tourism has been at the forefront of commercial space exploration for a very long time. Visions of weekend trips to Earth orbit and the Moon and Mars have been characterized with retro posters, and ventures have kept getting announced. But spaceships never show up. Well, all of that might be about to change. Two companies, Virgin Galactic and Blue Origin, are on the verge of completing development of their suborbital space tourism vehicles. Both of them have been performing rigorous test flights and are nearly ready to start taking their paying customers to the edge of space. Today, we'll be comparing their space tourism services and vehicles head to head. If you'd like to support more episodes of I Need More Space, consider getting a shirt at ineedmore.space/shop. Back to the episode. Spaceflight is exciting. The thrill of the launch, the feeling of floating freely in microgravity, and the magnificence of the Earth below you. The view of vast expanse where every human has spent their existence, the stage where all of our history took place, and one we call home now looking breathtakingly finite. This is the overview effect. The striking wave of realization upon seeing the Earth with your own eyes. A recalibration of what you already knew about our littleness, but hadn't fully processed. A momentary comprehension of our place in the universe. Up until now, astronauts have been the only ones fortunate enough to have experienced this. These have traditionally been professional space travelers from civilian or military space agencies. They include ex-military personnel, test pilots, and researchers. But now, commercial spaceflight companies like Virgin Galactic and Blue Origin are democratizing the overview effect. Virgin Galactic has been a consistent name in the spaceflight business ever since they were founded in 2004. Their vehicle, SpaceShipTwo, is a suborbital space plane which gets air launched from a massive twin fuselage carrier aircraft called White Knight 2. The spaceship itself is an iconic design from Burt Rutan. Let's take a moment to talk about Rutan. He is one of the most renowned aeronautical designers known to modern aviation. His company, Scaled Composites, has produced an astonishing number of bizarre aircraft designs known for their strength, efficiency, and generous canard placements. Seriously, look at these aircraft. Rutan's builds generally create or break world records. He has designed the Voyager, which in 1986 became the first plane to fly around the world without stopping or refueling. He then topped that with Virgin Galactic Global Flyer, which achieved the same feat even faster, within 67 hours. So it wasn't too much of a surprise when he was also the one to design Spaceship One, which became the first private crewed spacecraft to enter space. He then scaled this design, pun intended, into SpaceShip 2, which has similar capability and larger passenger capacity so that it can serve as Virgin Galactic's spaceship tourism vehicle. The spaceship is a vehicle with smooth, aerodynamic curves and silvery surfaces. It gets carried under the White Knight 2 to an altitude of 15 kilometers before it is released. A few seconds after the release occurs, the spaceship's hybrid engine ignites and the craft pitches upwards until it's ascending vertically. Within 90 seconds, engine burnout occurs. The spaceship and its passengers fly over the Kármán line at 100 kilometers and officially enter space. Since the craft is in free fall, its passengers experience microgravity. They can float around and look at the Earth through the windows. After nearly 4 minutes, the spaceship begins its descent phase. The feathering automatically corrects the orientation like a shuttlecock. As a result, the craft always enters right side up. After the majority of the descent is completed, the feathers fold down again to turn the spaceship into a very elegant underpowered glider that can land on a runway like a regular aircraft. Virgin Galactic has this very interesting advantage over most other suborbital space tourism companies. The fact that their system is a space plane. This means they could launch their passengers into space from anywhere on Earth, as long as you set up a base at a nearby airport. You could launch from Virgin's human spaceflight headquarters and space tourism hub, Spaceport America, over the arid desert landscape of New Mexico. But eventually they'll be able to launch from many similar spaceports all around the world. They have signed agreements with European launch sites like Spaceport Sweden to open up truly astounding capabilities such as launching passengers through the aurora borealis into space. The northern lights have been regarded as some of the most visually spectacular phenomena on the planet and above it. And being able to see them from suborbital space and then gliding back down to Earth will be an experience that many of their customers will be very interested in. But imagine for a second what other things you could do with such a space plane. You could launch over the Caribbean and gaze at the islands below, or over the Swiss Alps and watch the gargantuan peaks fall away and turn into rough disturbances on the planet's surface. You could launch over the South Pole and realize how fragile it all is, or over the Brazilian rainforests, the burning Australian landscape, or the African savannas. There are endless amount of possibilities for the parts of the world you could experience differently. And then there's the space flight. With either of these vehicles, you could view the blackness of space and the stars and the endless expanse as you float around. You can conduct microgravity experiments in chemistry, mechanics, and medical biological testing, or time it precisely to make unique observations of meteor showers or volcanic eruptions or re-entering spacecraft or absolutely anything else you could possibly think of. These are exciting times. Blue Origin's new Shepard is closer to the traditional rocket launch. It simply consists of a capsule on top of a booster. On flight day, the rocket is waiting on its pad in West Texas. Passengers board the capsule and strap into their seats, right next to the capsule's massive windows. Blue Origin loves to mention that these are the largest windows to fly in space, offering an unparalleled view of the planet from up above. The windows are pretty important when you think about it, when you've paid a few hundred thousand or maybe $1 million to fly to space and you don't have a large window. So I think it was a good investment. Blue has made sure that every seat is a window seat by designing the capsule around that. The capsule has an interior space of 530 cubic feet for the passengers to float around in while in microgravity. The middle of the capsule has what looks like a small, neat looking table. This is full of explosives. This is the top end of a solid rocket motor that acts as a launch abort system in case an anomaly happens with the booster, in which case it will fire and pull the passengers away to safety. Moments before liftoff, the new Shepard performs a series of checks by moving all of its control surfaces and ensuring that all of the actuators are working fine. Then, the BE-3 engine ignites, burning hydrogen and oxygen to propel the rocket upwards. After the target altitude is reached, the booster, which Blue calls the propulsion module, separates from the capsule, which continues upwards to the 100-kilometer Kármán line that marks the edge of space. The free fall lasts about 4 minutes, where the passengers can unstrap from their seats, float around, and look at the Earth below them. Researchers can even carry out experiments they've brought along or make observations. The craft then begins to re-enter the atmosphere in a traditional way. The capsule descends under parachutes and fires a short burst from rocket motors seconds before touchdown to provide a soft landing. The booster, on the other hand, is a bit more spectacular in its recovery. The booster first deploys drag-generating fins at the top of the vehicle that help slow it down in a controlled manner. The ring fins help stabilize it and guide it. As it approaches the pad, the BE-3 engine relights and the booster enters a propulsive descent and landing phase, vectoring the thrust and throttling the hydrolox engine very deep to gently guide it down. A few seconds before touchdown, the landing legs deploy and the booster performs a hover a short distance away from the concrete before gently setting itself down. Cheers ensue and a tiny robot crawls across the pad and puts out any fires that may occur. Virgin Galactic's development path for the spaceship hasn't been the smoothest ride. After Spaceship One reached space during its 2004 flight, the Spaceship Company was founded in 2005. They would be responsible for building the White Knight 2 and Spaceship 2 by 2008, and it was expected that they would be able to operate commercially and repeat the feat for customers by 2010. In 2007, a disaster occurred during an oxidizer flow test where a tank of nitrous oxide exploded. The shrapnel killed 3 employees and injured 3 others. They faced a ton of backlash, but the company endured. Some of these original targets were met, and the White Knight 2 named VMS Eve and the first Spaceship 2, VSS Enterprise, were built, which was unveiled at the Mojave Spaceport in 2009. However, aerospace schedules always shift to the right. An unpowered test didn't take place up until 2012, They're expecting the first real flight in 2013 and expecting commercial flights to begin in 2014. Around this time frame, the company decided to take over the rocket motor development and switch from the rubber-based HTPB fuel to a plastic-based thermoplastic polyamide. Modifications to Spaceship Two's airframe were required to hold extra tanks. In October of 2014, another major disaster occurred during a powered test flight of the VMS Enterprise. It suffered an in-flight failure and crashed, killing one of its pilots, Michael Alsbury, and injuring the other. This was a serious failure, and the National Transportation Safety Board conducted an independent investigation. It was discovered that one of the reentry feathers of the spaceship had deployed and swung back shortly after separation and ignition, leading to the loss of the control of the craft. Inadequate design safeguards, poor pilot training, and lack of rigorous FAA oversight were cited as the reasons. After the incident, the replacement spaceship Unity was completed and put through rigorous tests. The fuel was switched back to HTPB. Testing continued, and the Spaceship Two reached the edge of space at the 80-kilometer altitude in 2018. It repeated a similar flight in 2019 and is expected to be able to fly customers soon. Virgin plans to build and operate a total fleet of 5 Spaceship Twos and 2 White Knight Twos. They have made comments about leveraging this development to create a high-speed, supersonic, point-to-point flight service. Blue Origin's motives to develop the new Shepard have been quite different. They believe in not wanting to skip development steps, which is why they plan to start with a small suborbital vehicle and slowly work their way up to a gargantuan orbital-class rocket, the New Glenn. But there is another reason why Blue Origin developed the new Shepard, something I've also discussed in the SpaceX vs. Blue Origin video. By developing New Shepard with a deep throttling hydrolox engine and precise propulsive landing capabilities, they were able to test many of the technologies that require for the development of their Blue Moon lunar lander. Blue Origin has conducted a rigorous, uncrewed test campaign for the New Shepard booster and capsule, including suborbital space shots, numerous capsule recoveries and booster landings, and multiple reflights of the same booster. They have even flown some commercial research payloads and will begin flying passengers soon. NASA has also recently announced that they are soliciting both Blue Origin and Virgin Galactic for suborbital space crew transportation services to send their astronauts on flights to help conduct trainings, testing of spaceflight hardware, and human-tended microgravity research. This makes a ton of sense if you think about it. Since orbital launches are so cost prohibitive, NASA wants to find an affordable way to train their new astronauts in a space environment before they send them to low Earth orbit and beyond. So, we have looked at both the suborbital spaceflight companies leading the spaceflight tourism market today. Which one would you rather fly on? Virgin's shiny space plane, the Spaceship Two, or Blue Origin's booster system, New Shepard? Let me know in the comments section below. Do let me know what episodes you'd like to see in the future in this versus or head-to-head series I've been making. I'd really love any suggestions you may have. If you want more spaceflight goodies and stories not on YouTube, feel free to follow me on Twitter. I'm at TJ_Cooney, where I just share all kinds of space news and fun facts and reflections that I find interesting that I think you would enjoy. Anyways, I hope you learned something new today. Please consider subscribing and giving this video a like, and let me know in the comments what you think about all of this. All right, thanks for watching. I hope you have a great day.